never seen this game. So, I don't know. This seems to be a trend.
During this marathon.
That's right, it's all about the moral support.
But you're lawful evil.
Oh, yeah.
What does that even... Oh, no, 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 I see.
It's Do you want the explanation? I'm happy to tell you while they're sorting things out with the timer.
Actually, I should probably say
a couple things about the character, too, since we're here and we've got a little time. We are lawful evil specifically because your alignment determines what abilities your familiar has. Every spellcaster as a main character can summon a familiar to travel around with you. And lawful evil familiars gain the ability to polymorph themselves once per day, which is going to be relevant about 3 minutes into the run.
They crop the sides off. Is that okay?
No. The way you had it before was actually better.
Okay, so you can polymorph?
The familiar will be able to polymorph, yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you have, like, 7 strength, 18 dexterity, 18 constitution.
So in Baldur's Gate and Baldur's Gate 2 and all the Infinity Engine games, you get the ability to subtract and add numbers to your stats as you like from a stat pool that you've rolled, and you can reroll as many times as you like. In this case, I have chosen to take a wisdom of 6, which is the minimum wisdom requirement for a witch spell. It's going to happen about 17 minutes into the run. And then the dexterity and constitution scores are just keep me alive. Intelligence is my spellcasting modifier, and charisma is for the easiest way to get into a properly in the run. Strength is almost entirely irrelevant, so it's wherever I dump the rest of my points.
Cool. Wait, you talk yourself into a prison?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
And you need a high charisma for it, too, because the alternative is getting stabbed.
I think, are you all ready for the run to begin? I personally am.
So this is Baldur's Gate 2 Enhanced Edition, and the Enhanced Edition was released in 2013 by Beamdog Studios to modernize... a pretty old franchise for modern operating systems, and to add some original content. What we actually care about for the speedrun purposes is that it allows us to stack our speed buffs together. So about halfway through the run, we're going to be picking up Boots of Speed and combining it with Haste Spells and Oils of Speed to get 4x movement rate.
Oh, nice.
We start off with this lovely 90-second long unskippable cutscene, but shortly thereafter we'll have to pick spells, and we'll meet the first NPC that we're using, which is Imowen. And Imowen's actually critical for 2 skips as we leave the dungeon. And because there are so many glitches and complicated things going on in the run, I'm going to be trying to use the time during these cutscenes to explain what's going on. As it's happening, it's going to be really fast, so it'll be hard for me to keep up. The biggest skip coming up after I leave this dungeon, it's about 4 minutes away, maybe 5, is going to be the Imowen skip and the multiple dialogue glitch. And they're both based on the idea that when this game checks to see if 2 characters are close enough together to have a conversation, it only compares 2 sets of coordinates. It doesn't actually check what map they're on. So by maneuvering Imowen into a position that matches the coordinates I emerge from the dungeon, I can force her to start dialogue with me even though we're not standing on the same map. And that's going to interrupt the cutscene and allow me to act naturally, and it's going to do some really wacky stuff momentarily. But first I need to grab some spells.
Gotcha. I'm trying to think. It follows a little bit. This is going to sound dumb. It's like a D&D game.
It is literally a D&D game.
It is literally. The antidote one.
Here's Yoshimo. Yoshimo's a super cool dude. We're going to use him to soak a spell effect to the face. a safety save in there. This room is actually the hardest pull in the speedrun. And it's really dumb because anybody who played this casually knows that this is like the intro starter fight. It's not supposed to be challenging.
Wait, do you have a bear?
Yes, that is something that I mentioned earlier when I mentioned the ability to polymorph. My is now a bear, and that is because bears are awesome.
Okay, that's pretty awesome. You know, I barely caught that. Just wanted to let you know.
Oh boy, we're starting early today, huh?
Well,
I knew it was coming. I mean, I really asked for it. I literally asked for it.
We've only got half an hour, okay?
That's true. We got less than half an hour if everything goes. Oh God.
We do have a few donations.
Yes, there's actually going to be a lot going on right now. Pretty soon, I'll let you know.
All right.
So I'm setting up the MON skip and the multiple dialogue glitch right here. First things first, I'm actually meeting myself in the hallway. So I've got MON hanging out on this side. Main character's coming up the hallway the long way. And the game checks to see if you're close enough to give items to each other, but not if there's intervening terrain. So I just chuck it through the wall. That seems like the right way to do it. So here is the first skip. This is the easier of the two. And this is a cutscene skip. I go here, our coordinates match. She talks to me. I can put the bear back in my backpack. And the cutscene that's supposed to play here never fires. But now I'm manipulating a little bit of the way the game stores memory to do the MON skip. There's some RNG to this, so it might take me a few tries to get it in, but if I get there, first try, I'll take it.
Hey!
Yeah, that's actually probably the hardest timing-wise skip. There's some amount of RNG, but it's mostly predictable. There's three different cycles. It's a half a second and a half, and 2.5 seconds. So I got the best cycle, and that saves a lot of time. Here I'm also dual classing. I need to have access to pickpocketing for a lot of the runs, so I'm going to be dual classing right now to get that done. But when I dual class, I lose the ability to cast my wizard spells. We're going to fix that really soon.
How many levels did you just give yourself for pickpocketing?
Not that many. So here I'm using the first multiple dialogue. I use it to avoid some, essentially the whole cutscene. The way that it works, and I didn't get a chance to explain that earlier, but the idea behind multiple dialogue is the game is trying to unload the original dungeon from memory because I no longer have any active party members there. But MON starts dialogue with me before that part of the script fires. Conversation because she is unloaded from the game's memory at the same time that the map is unloaded from the game's memory. Her dialogue remains in my dialogue window, and I can still continue to click it, and it's hard-coded to responses for other NPCs that are not MON. In this case, I used dialogue for an NPC that's not in my party, which caused the conversation to end prematurely. And then I used dialogue to give 20,000 gold to that man that I obviously don't have.
This is getting a little intense.
It's a little weird. We're going to do a little bit more with multiple dialogue here, and then we're mostly done with it. We'll do a little bit more towards the end of the game as well. But mostly it's skipping chapter 2, which is entirely a money grind. Not really a whole lot of anything getting skipped that we actually want to see in the speedrun. And I'm doing it here to prevent me from having to do two fetch quests. I've also split the party because we're going to cut Yoshimo from the party here. We don't want him anymore. And we need to level up a lot right now. Turning in those two fetch quests gave me a whole lot of experience. All right. And we also need to get rid of Yoshimo. Sorry, dude. We like you, but we're done with you now. I'm going to wait a second here for him to start pathing towards me. And once he starts walking, I need to get new spells.
When you get a chance, could you, if you know what your runner's choice is going to be, we do have a couple of donations for runner's choice.
Oh, goodness. I actually have no idea what my runner's choice is going to be, but I will think about it.
You could always do Earthbound naming the player Happy Birthday, Solomon.
I'm going to throw Solomon a bone and not do that. So this is the first sort of RNG gatekeeper of the run. It's where a lot of time gets lost. I've actually lost in my previous playthroughs. Oh, wow. Okay, well, we'll take the first one, I guess. That's pretty good. I've lost up to 10.5 minutes in this sequence. We are going to do this in about 4 seconds. So what you missed there was I turned him into a squirrel, and then I put a meteor on that squirrel. Now there's no longer a squirrel, but I took all of his shoes. So that's pretty cool.
Turn a guy into a squirrel, chuck a meteor at him,
yes.
And then take his shoes.
It's just another day in the life, you know? That's what we do. I do a lot of buying and selling of stuff here. What you're seeing is, what I did is I I identified this wand that I got from the first dungeon. Then I sold it. When you sell it to a vendor, they recharge it to full. So it's recharged. I steal it and then sell it again. It's worth a lot more when it's recharged to full. I steal it one more time because I still need it. And then I spend the money that I just got from him to buy a couple of scrolls. And we're going on a vampire hunt.
Oh.
So I'm going to say a couple quick things about the vampire, and then feel free to go crazy with the donations. The vampire has no death animation. When you reduce him to one hit point, a coffin on the other side of the complex becomes clickable. At that time, even though he'll see him somewhere else, I can stake him in his coffin. And you can basically go ahead with your donations for now, and I'll let you know when I need to get the mic.
All right, there are several. I do want to plug, there's a couple of incentives coming up later today. There is the post-run Glitch Fest for Secret of Mana, any percent. That's at 511 out of 1,500. Console disc cam for Dragon Quest V is nothing out of 250. Fighting Kulex in Super Mario RPG is at just under 1,600 out of 3,500. Visit Link and Samus, Super Mario RPG is at 130 out of 750. Fighting the first Demon Wall of Final Fantasy XII, 235 out of 750. Fighting the Elder Worm, 120 out of 750. Singing the credits has been met. We also have game choice Star Tropics versus Star Tropics 2, which is going to be about this time tomorrow. A few donations I'll try to run through. Big Steve donates $25. I'm ready to see some sidekicks in the Star Ocean run. That was to name Nell B! Exclamation point. $5 donation from Dejumbi. Another big shout-out to Ben Epley, a.k.a. B., whose favorite game is Star Ocean 3. He also does the best wrestling moves like The Shot, which he used on Toon El Bombador. This donation is going towards naming Nell B. in honor of Ben Epley. $25 from Kirby. Hey, Koal, Kirby here, don't mess up.
Thanks, Kirby. Appreciate it, man.
$25 from Grimora. Please decimate this game. Watch out for dragons. That goes to Runner's Choice. $50 from Klep. Hey, Koal, good luck with the run. This donation also goes to Runner's Choice.
Thanks, Klep.
And $1 from Adventure Academy. When are you making a Pretty Percent Dude, Pretty for Life? And let me see where that's going. That is going towards leveling up Ark's macho stat in Terranigna any percent. I thought that run
that
is
must
already
be an older donation.
Must
yeah.
be.
Snuck in here. Back from the dead.
I'm going to grab the mic back. Storyline here. We missed a cutscene where Imogen and this evil villain who we don't really know anything about allowed themselves to be essentially. To take over the prison from the inside and use it for devious experiments. But it's a hidden prison, and we needed to charter a vessel and hire the Shadow Thieves to find out where this prison even is. So now we're going to get into the prison, and the sort of gate warden is the pirate captain that is the leader of this town. And I'm bribing his doorman to let me into his house, and then I'm going to tell him that I want in. And he takes me in.
Aw.
So ordinarily, if you talk to him, he wants to hit you with a scimitar more than he wants to let you in here, so... that's what the 18 charisma is for. It's literally the only thing we use it for in the entire run.
To be really persuasive, it's like, I think I need to go to jail now.
Yeah, that's literally all it is. So this is getting back to the familiar skip. I did this really early in the run to get through that one locked door. We're doing it again here. I'm going to need to use one more charge on the wand, it looks like. That's kind of a bummer, but that's all right. There we go. That should do. So what's happening here is it tries to put me in the next valid location, and it's not going to be able to get me into any of these places that are already occupied. So instead, it allows me to shove a bear through a keyhole. Yes. That bear.
Clap for the bear.
Yeah. Well, we're going to do it again, so if you really like bears, congratulations. But yeah, so one of the weird things about the way that the game is scripted is one of the skips that we've done earlier, and I'm not even familiar with which skip it is, prevents the part of the script from firing that unpolymorphs the bear. It's supposed to have a duration, but this bear will be a bear forever.
Oh.
Things go well. And we're going to have another probably 30 seconds here. If you have anything you want to read off, now's probably the time.
I am pleased. My revenge will soon come.
I do not currently have any donations. Nothing's come in. Have you had a chance to think more about where you might want Runner's Choice to go? Because there are still a couple donations waiting there.
Yeah, I'll probably have to take a look and see what's on the tracker for that. But I'll get back to you as soon as I can. I've got a couple things I can say here, actually, while we're watching the cutscene. The first thing is we're going to be talking to a Duergar merchant right away as soon as we get down to the Undark. And he's got two item lists. One of the very first things that was patched out of this game after release is to correct that merchant. It's supposed to be that his premium item list is only offered to Drow, and the idea is we're supposed to get disguised as Drow and come back to him. But for whatever reason, on the first release of the game, the first time you ever talk to him, he always offers you the premium items, which is something we're going to be taking advantage of because he has two very important scrolls for the end of the game. And my haste has worn off, so let's fix that. So that merchant is right down here. And we need to steal from him. And we're not going to use these for a while. We're getting Tensor's Transformation, and we are getting Limited Wish. And there's one more thing I need from him that's not on his premium list. It's on his regular list, and that's this True Sight scroll.
I do have one quick $20 donation from Kimbo. Says, hashtag Team Koal, heart an evil spirit.
Thanks, Kimbo.
It does not look like that this donation has gone towards anything in particular, so if you would like to put that towards something, please let us know. If you're putting this towards Runner's Choice, please also let us know of that, and we'll take care of that. Thank you.
So is there any risk when you're stealing all those items?
Not especially. There's a little bit of risk with the guy I just pickpocketed. So basically what's going on down here in the Underdark is this cave is too dark to enter, and that gnome is the mayor of a gnome town who has a sun gem that allows us to enter this cave. We're supposed to do a side quest for him and help out the town, and then he gives me the gem as a reward. We don't have time for that, so I just steal it from him. There's an ambush party spawning just off the bottom of my screen here. It only spawns probably 80% of the time. It seems completely random. I think it has something to do with processor speed more than any specific triggers. And here I'm setting up the final instance of the multiple dialogue glitch using this dragon. The dragon wants to disguise us as Drow to get us into the Drow city to steal back her dragon eggs and return them to her. But we're evil, and we also don't care about that. So we're even going to use her dialogue in an even more evil way, which is going to be to glitch this game even more. You now resemble the denizens. So she's really weird because we don't actually have a numerical response to click for her. But whenever there's no response, clicking the space underneath the dialogue advances the text as though you picked option number one. And it happens to be that the two times we need multiple dialogue for the rest of the run, it's going to be clicking option number one anyway. So she doesn't realize it yet, but not only am I not going to help her, but she's going to help me in a lot of ways on the surface. So here, because I look like a drow, I can bribe this guy and go right out the front door, and that's the entire Underdark sequence. There's a lot going on up here. We don't want to deal with any of it. What we do want to do is change our spells around, and this is unfortunately the scariest part of the run for me. There are two cutscene skips going on here, and if I miss either one of them, I lose about a minute and a half. So I'm going to be milking the pause button a little bit here. Got it. So normally what happens is the advisors get spawned and he does this super long dialogue, and in addition to being super long, it also stretches out the text on my dialogue box so much that this multiple dialogue glitch that I've set up will scroll all the way off the top and I won't be able to use it anymore. And I need to preserve it for the black dragon in the next area. So if I don't talk lock those guys before they start the cutscene, and I should explain talk lock momentarily as well, they will actually have this super long dialogue and force me to screw up the cutscene skip and all this other stuff. And I also just used multiple dialogue to skip having to go find Bodai and the Rin Lanthorns. People who played this before know you're supposed to go fight some vampires. Turns out that the Silver Dragon is going to help me skip that too. So the talk locking that I mentioned earlier is a pretty well-known glitch in this run, and that is that if you click to talk on somebody, they actually wait for the thing that you do, because they're expecting you to start a conversation. So I used that earlier when I was casting Polymorph Other on that guy in the Thieves' Warehouse there, and that's actually how you do it without him aggroing to you. So here it's a puzzle box that gives us one of the quest items we need to advance the plot. And there's three things we're trying to collect while we're here in Solden Esselar. We need to get three artifacts to summon the Avatar of Rillafane, which is sort of like an elven demigod protector spirit guardian type thing. And he's going to kill all the bad guys here for us. That's going to be super helpful. Here I'm using the last use of multiple dialogue in the run. This is to get dialogue for a bribery option. Normally it requires 30,000 gold. You can see it currently I have zero. So maybe not so much. And he's also not smart enough to take the items that I've dropped on the floor. So even though he's supposed to take all of my money and all of my items, he didn't. So thanks, Dragon. Certainly not.
Yeah, you are lawful evil.
Yeah, you remember I rolled evil. I mean, that's what we're all about. So I help someone in this run. I help Nameter in this run.
Oh, yay.
I do have one $10 donation from Fizu, who says, good luck, Koal. In my heart, this protagonist remains beardy. Also, mine hey, Brocentia, what was Loki's excuse when he turned up the party long after it started?
Tell me, what was his excuse?
Baldur's late, too.
Oh.
That
sounds like a bad improv scene.
Yeah, I give that one like a C+.
At least you tried.
It's okay. I like you, Faizu.
And I appreciate the avatar. It's too bad we didn't get a chance to use it.
Oh, yeah, we made an avatar in case it was beardy, but that's okay. Purple lady face is kicking some major booty here.
Yeah, this is actually going really well. Purple lady face has some very good RNG today.
Yeah.
So one of the things that happened a moment ago that I should explain is I used Limited Wish there. Limited Wish spawns a genie that asks you what you want to wish for, and it's why I have a Wisdom of 6. It allows me to wish for these shape change spell effects longer than the game. So in this case, if I make 20 seconds worth of mistakes, it might fall off before the run is over, and if that's the case, I need to revert to an earlier save. So in previous runs, I've used pause to try and make sure that I don't run out of time. Generally speaking, I've been avoiding doing that lately, so we'll see if I can play it a little riskier here. It also allowed me to interrupt the cutscene that was playing inside of that house, so instead of having to wait 30 seconds for the two of them to kill each other, I just pickpocketed the good guy and walked out.
Good plan.
Theme in this run. So I collected a harp and a horn, and I need those to give to these statues to drain the water out of the staircase, the physics of which I don't really understand, because we're draining the water out, and then there's stairs here that look like they sort of go down-ish, but I'm going to an area that certainly looks like I'm going up instead. Normally I can skip her dialogue, but oh well. So it's kind of weird. I don't really understand how those stairs work, but whatever. So here I use shape change for the first time, and it's to transform into a mind flayer. And being a mind flayer is the easiest way to complete the finale of the game, because mind flayers can deal damage to the intelligence stat. And if your stat gets reduced to zero, doesn't matter what stat it is, you just die. So these guys have about 160 hit points. They have about 6 intelligence. So being a mind flayer kills them way faster. And also I cast a spell called Tensor's Transformation. And in AD&D, Tensor's Transformation was a spell that gave wizards essentially fighter stats. So right now I have fighter stats and I'm a mind flayer, and I'm just eating the brains of corrupted elementals.
Yes, finish it quickly. I feel the tree of life dying. John is drawing too close to his goal.
She got really excited about that part.
Oh, yeah. So here I give a little brief delay because sometimes there's some funny stuff that happens with the script that starts this fight. We actually have to beat this boss by running off screen before he casts his spell protections. The AI is not smart enough to cast them while we're off screen. But for some reason, sometimes during this little animation here, he'll cast it anyway. So we need to make sure that I have a quick save lined up in case that happens. It didn't happen this time, so we're good. And I'm using what's called the quick slot item glitch here. And basically the idea is that in casting a spell, one of the very last parts of the script is to remove the scroll from your inventory. And as long as I keep moving it around, I can cast it indefinitely. If I leave it in one spot, in this case, 3 castings is enough to kill him off screen and send us to the final chapter. So that was your epic, quote-unquote, final battle. Here I want to turn back into a human because mind flayers can't normally cast spells. They can use scrolls, but they can't normally cast spells. Get a little dialogue here with myself. And I'm going to refresh haste at this time. So I drank an oil of speed earlier. Oil of speed works just like haste for the purposes of... wrong spell. Whatever. For the purposes of increasing your movement rate. But it also lasts a lot longer. So we're supposed to be doing these trials to master the self. I'm only going to do one of them, and I'm going to do the fear trial, because I cast a spell just now called Remove Fear. It makes me immune to fear. So thanks for that trial. I guess I mastered the self. We're in pretty good shape now.
I feel like you have.
I feel pretty solid about my ability to feel fear.
Good.
So just like before, with dropping my stuff on the ground for the Black Dragon, I can actually use the same quest item here 4 times to set up the final battle. And I've got some scrolls to read, starting with this one here. This is True Sight. True Sight penetrates illusion magic. I also really want haste, because if it wears off during this fight, I am just dead. And I want to be a mind flayer again, because even though the antagonist it's still a lot faster than chewing through his hit points. So here he's going to transform into the avatar of the dead god of murder, cast a bunch of spell protections, and summon four of the giant, most awesome demons he can find. They are all melee bruisers, every single one of them, and I am really fast. So I'm just going to run away from them. See you guys later. And he just had his spell protection fall off because of my true sight spell. Gets rid of the mislead. Made a little copy of him right over here. And get ready on time. It's whenever time stop wears off. Time.
Holy cow.
That's not too bad. That's like 30 seconds off my PB. So that was Baldur's Gate 2 Enhanced Edition. A lot of what was going on there is essentially all of his spell protections and all of his AC and everything don't really matter under the effects of time stop. So I get to hit him four times under time stop and he just dies. His intelligence goes to zero and he's just gone.
So how fast would you normally expect to play, like, casually a playthrough of Baldur's Gate 2?
100 hours.
Well.
Without a doubt. I could spend 80 hours in Chapter 2.
Okay, that's easily. Good to know.
I think anybody who played this as a kid probably spent 80 hours in Chapter 2.
How long did you spend in Chapter 2 on this one?
I didn't actually have Chapter 2 in this one. I'm monstrously underestimate. Do you guys want to have, like, the final cinematic?